watch how I paint this acrylic painting of snapdragons inspired by a trip to Garfield Park Conservatory in Chicago. I'd love to show you more pictures of the place, but we're going to get into the whole snapdragons thing. This video was requested by Lynn Dow, a subscriber. She saw the time-lapse video of this very thing, about 10 minutes long, and asked for a real-time video, and I was very happy to oblige. I don't know where my channel's going, but until I figure out where I'm going, I'm happy to give whatever kind of suggestions and do the thing. So we're going to do the thing. Here's my palette. We're starting with titanium white. These are all acrylic paints. I use a lot of Golden and Liquitex brand. The ultramarine blue, I mean, you can read them right here. Ultramarine blue light, cadmium yellow medium, probably the hue. I don't know if that's the right one. And quinacridone red. I love the quinacridone red families. And emerald green, which is a tube color. I usually mix my own greens. But this one was a gift from someone, another artist, who we just swapped paints. She went to oils. She had some acrylics. And I like using up these unique little tubes. It kind of pops away. So this painting was originally, I'd already painted it blue, probably for a sky for something. Although I usually do a magenta background when I'm doing a landscape. So I'm not sure why I painted it blue, but I decided to go with it and use it because we're actually putting another color in the foreground now. Now, as I go over talking about this video and doing things in real time, I'm going to ramble on a little bit. I taught art for 4 years, kind of paint and sip, but more academic. So I like to break down all the nerdly art things and the whys for why I'm drawing or how to draw. But because I didn't record this originally to teach or to draw out these certain shapes, it feels like I'm almost going over in a rough draft. Like, these are all the things I would do differently. So it's not designed to be a tutorial on how to, but you can see how I did and, you know, learn some stuff from there. And that's what it's for, and that's why I am more than happy to oblige if you want to see a real-time video like this. So you'll see I'm drawing, this is drawing with graphite on acrylic. It doesn't stick that well, and you just saw me wipe some away with water. There is actually water-soluble graphite out there. You saw me use those long lines to show where these snapdragon cones are leaning a little bit. It's really stiff if they're just straight up and down, like my reference images right there. I recommend Pixabay and Morgfile, as well as, I think there's a Wikimedia Commons. You can get some royalty-free reference images, and you don't have to really worry about royalties if you happen to sell that art later on, or if you wanted to show it for something like this. Pixabay is one of my favorite ones right now. Morgfile, I find the quality of the pictures harder to sift through. Another thing I wouldn't normally do for a tutorial, or hardly ever myself these days, is draw the outline of these flowers like this. Now, I'm doing that partially because I want to save that blue in the background, and so I want to know where my paint stops when I put this on. And you're going to see a very blobby, tapping, blob technique. It's impressionistic, so I don't blend that much, honestly. And you're going to see me try to stay in some of those outlines, and then half of my lines are obliterated. Anyway, that's the way I do it. It's almost like I remember where these things are, or it's a memory thing, just sketching out where I think I want stuff and to save outlines anywhere else. These are unique little shaped flowers. I'd like to look at it again, I think. That's kind of half the fun of an impressionistic painting, is that you don't get bogged down in the details of rendering the individual shapes. Right now I'm more interested in the outline, like the negative shape of the flower in the background, and like, I don't even know what to call these individual flowers on a snapdragon. So you've got one in the foreground, those little four-petaled head doohickeys, and it's on the same cone. So I want to make sure it pops out and you can still see it's on that same cone. I'm using a Sharpie China marker right here. It's kind of like a crayon pencil hybrid, where it's meant to right on slick surfaces, but also not smudge. I think you can take it off with alcohol for china, because that's what it's for, marking china for priceage or whatever. And I was trying to experiment with things that wouldn't smudge. It's also not really that erasable, especially the Sharpie version, because that's what Sharpie does. But it also sticks a lot better than graphite. I don't know what the longevity is for underneath acrylic paint. You know, 100 years, if I'm rich and dead and famous. Well, they can figure that out. Sorry guys, I'm dead at that point. But it is sticking a bit more for those lines I want to keep. Yeah, it's black. Alright, time for the painting. I'm using this little angled brush. Again, this painting is all about those extra little bits I had laying around. I don't often use this little angled brush. And now I'm going to use it entirely for this painting right here. I've mixed up some sky color already, and I'm going to go around. Never mind, okay. See, this is what happens when I narrate it after I've recorded it months ago. Because I thought I went around some of these things for the sky, but I'm actually using that thin part of the angled brush to block in some of what I want to be lighter in the foreground with the petals. And I'm going to be going back and forth and back and forth a lot with colors. I believe all this stuff is going to be obliterated out by other layers later on. I tend to use a lot of glazing with acrylics, or at least trying to get brighter colors on top. So if I were to put a transparent color, and I will later on top of that blue, it will have a blue tinged, basically, and it will become darker. So if I want something lighter, like a light green, I really need it opaque, and adding white to acrylic paint can make it chalky. Also opaque, of course, but it can compromise the brilliance of the color, unless it's like a canned green, like the emerald I'm going to be using. It's also very opaque, but it's mixed together by itself to be really bright. But what I'm doing by adding those little white bits at the bottom is to give a brighter background for any other color to be clearer on top of. That's my excuse. That's my fancy artist speak for why I do that. Sometimes I call it repriming. I'm just making that up completely, by the way. Something lighter to glaze off of. And blocking the sky in. This is why I'm drawing those little sections around the snapdragons at the top. Lots of dabby dabby blah 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 with an angled brush. I don't often use the very tip of that brush right there to add tiny dots. I don't remember seeing that too much, honestly. I do use it for making longer lines like you saw with those stems, and just a lot of dabbing because I'm right-handed and it's a great angle just to do that. It's kind of a blocky brush and I like it. The nice thing about small canvases and having your palette right there is that you can do the edges of your canvas and not have to worry about remixing your colors later. Some things I often forget, and I actually used to do all the edges black because it's a lot more painting. It adds up, especially if you use a thick canvas. You're doing a lot more square inch painting. This is slow dry painting medium. It's also called a retarder because it literally slows down the drying of acrylic paint. There are so many mediums out there. This one's by Liquitex, a big old jar of this stuff. It can make acrylic paint act a little bit more like oils, partially because of it slowing down the drying process, but it feels a little more greasy too, honestly, especially with this Liquitex brand. I haven't tried too many other brands. I believe I tried Michael's store brand. They're cheap little $4 ones. They've got great little cheap mediums to try out if you're not sure what these things do. It's gummy, though, and it stays kind of tacky afterwards, which is why I moved on from that, but it's great for testing out mediums. All right, I'm using some of that ultramarine blue mixed in with quinacridone red. I've got some deep, deep purples because both of those, more so ultramarine blue, is really transparent, and that can give you really nice deep darks. Again, transparent on top of blue again. Quinacridone reds can vary on their transparency, but I believe this one in particular is pretty transparent. So I'm loving to use purples as my darkest darks. To make purple go even more neutral and not just be purple, you would add something yellowy. But you have to be careful. Not many yellows are created to be transparent. It would almost defeat the purpose of some yellows because you wouldn't be able to see it. Long story. A lot of yellows are not transparent that I know of, or the ones I use. So it wouldn't be as dark if I mixed it with that purple right now. Raw umber would actually be the way to go. Anyhow, here I'm kind of dabbing in what would be the background flowers. If you squinted at this painting, that's how I do impressionist paintings. I'm pretty nearsighted myself, so if I'm squinting at something, that's what I'm painting. That also helps me not get bogged down in details, but this gives an illusion of depth and also of more flowers in the background, and you're going to see me dab a similar shape, like these big flowers in the background, giving it a bit of depth and to show that there are more flowers like this, but not have you focus on them, so they're going to be blurred out like that. I also like using the same tones of colors in the background or just around the painting so it doesn't have a coloring book effect where all of one color is in just one spot. That doesn't feel very unified to me, at least when I paint. I see tons of other painters use it and it's perfectly fine, but I like to dabble them around a little bit. That is not why my channel is called Dabble Bag. That's a different story. But you see me, dabbing again and putting little blobs of paint on and basically obliterating those little lines I made, which is what I do. Since I'm not going to be really in that spot and blending away little shadows, especially for a tiny canvas like this, I would actually recommend going larger the more abstract a painting you're doing. Because a large painting, you're designed to be stepped back from, like 6 feet, good 3-6 feet. And the abstract pieces can be viewed as a whole like they're supposed to be. I go up and look at paint strokes, but I'm an artist nerd. But a regular viewer is going to stand farther back and see it all. So I'm wondering, for you who do, all out there in the world, who do tiny abstracts, why tiny? I mean, do you find that your viewers approach them differently when they're tiny? Like sets of tiny abstracts? Is there still like a density or a scale of abstraction you go to on tiny canvases because they're viewed differently? This one I also designed to be a greeting card on the front, so it's kind of a happy generic kind of thing, and you can go over it with text easily without, I don't know, confusing what you're seeing. So there will be a link below if I remember to do it, where you can actually get prints of this little guy when it's done. Now, like I said before, I was an art teacher at Michael's for quite a while, so I like doing art classes, and there's different things, different crafty stuff I might be getting into later, but this particular video that I made wasn't designed for that to begin with, and there'd be different things I'd do if the general populace who finds my videos wants more of those. You know, there's stuff we can do, we'll see where we go from here. So if you like stuff like this and you want something more step by step on how to draw things, let's see what happens. Another thing to consider is what I can make consistently, and these can be rather time consuming. Oh, candy pliers opening up that emerald green. It's so true. Acrylic paint sticks really good. Pliers. An indispensable art tool. Who knew? Yes, I'm sorry if that palette drives you insane. It's supposed to peel off when you have thick enough paint here and there, and I do mix a lot with my brush, which is something else I don't always recommend because you can overload your brush with gunk. Also where a lot of mud comes from, and then you have unexpected results on your canvas. I am all for playing with paint and letting paint do its glorious thing, but I want to be done intentionally, like play intentionally, make messes intentionally. I would tell my students a lot that, hey, if you mess something up, cool, good for you. Life goes on. If you don't like it, okay, we'll fix it. That's, you're not wasting paint, you're learning. But if you do it again on purpose, it's called a technique. And that's how art history has been made. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk. Meanwhile, back to the dark shadows below here. More of that ultramarine blue. That's a really green ultramarine blue. I'm curious if I have a green shade of that, or usually I have the red shade. Warm and cool shades of colors. Normally you might think of cool colors being only blue and violets and greens. Well, yeah, you can start there, absolutely. But that's where you get into trouble if you assume all blues are made the same. Obviously, I said that because they're not. So, I don't know if I can explain how cool and warm blues and reds and oranges are with the equipment I have. I'm not sure if the colors would come across. There are tons of YouTube channels that do that very well. I'm sure I'd love to make my own sometime and explain it a little bit. Ultramarine blue is a pretty warm reddish blue. If you looked up right next to a phthalo blue, it's kind of like musical note. You're like, wow, I hear a musical note, cool, but you don't know the difference until you hear a different note right next to it. So it's hard to describe why this blue is different if you don't see another one next to it with good lighting. This is a very warm yellow. I mean, squint. Come on, you see kind of a very orangey yellow of that cadmium yellow at the bottom right. Cadmium yellow medium would make it kind of dark. You can get warms and cools of cadmium yellows. I will often use cadmium yellow hues, and that's a fake of cadmium, which is kind of a heavy metal. Again, you see me kind of nerding out about the pigments of colors. I'd love to do that to my students and tell them the history of pigments and where all these things came from. Don't take your art theory for granted, like, why do we have six colors? But you're here for the Snapdragons, right? I don't know much about them, honestly. Apparently, they're these cool little pockety flowers that you can squeeze and it has a little face, like a dragon. It can be bitey. I wish I'd learned more about these little guys. I find these 3D petal faces fascinating. You may have heard my cat right there. I locked him out of the studio so I can record in peace. You might hear him having a fit because I locked him out of the studio to record in peace. And he just likes attention and meowing. He is my studio assistant. So cadmium yellows, it's don't breathe it, don't eat it. Please don't be licking your paint anyway, like any of these. Ironically, there's a lot of elements in paint that is used for all sorts of things. This is titanium white. Basically, it's the rust of titanium. A lot of paints actually are rust of something, like these siennas and burnt siennas. It's rust or ochre. It is rust that's kind of suspended. But I believe titanium white is kind of like oxidized titanium, so it's rust of a metal in a way. Zinc white is a transparent white, or mixing white it's called. And this is the same kind of zinc oxide, again, metal rust, the oxide of zinc, that's in your sunscreen. So there's a lot of just chemical properties with this stuff that if you're on a desert island and you only have a tube of paint, I mean, that's one thing you could do with it, I guess. But, so now you know a bit of science nerding things on what's inside paint tubes and your sunscreen. More dabby-dabby of that paint over there with this little brush. You may notice I don't cut out to rinse this little guy off that much. Partially because I'll probably rinse it right there, honestly. I'm wiping it off with too much water on your brush. The paint doesn't mix right and doesn't stick right anymore. Yes, acrylic is absolutely a water medium, and you can rinse off and you can thin it down and do all sorts of stuff like that, but too much water, it doesn't stick right, and then it dries in different times for different layers, and you can actually pick it back up if it's too wet and you have a sticky brush. So usually if there's too much water on my brush anyway, I'll still pinch it off in like paper towel or something like that anyway, and that gets most of the paint out. If you don't clean it out just right, it can get muddy as well, which is why you don't mix with your brush. Don't do this right here, don't do it. Use a palette knife. Also, who cares about the rules? We're artists. Mix with your brush if you want, and learn the hard way how to avoid mud colors. I love yellow skies. They remind me of the sky after a storm. It's just something different. It's after a storm, or maybe the bright early morning. I like yellow skies. And I'm actually mixing that one with a whole bunch of everything. Blues and those oranges kind of dull it down. So you'll see me going back and forth. I like the little blues still poking out, giving that negative shape. So the best way I can describe a negative shape, if you're curious about that and why I'm going the edges, and I'm very careful to preserve that strong shape of the Snapdragon. If you squint at this painting, and that's one of the best tools you've got about painting is squinting. If you can't t pick up your brush, and oh, I'm sorry, if you can't pick up your painting and hold it, okay, if you can hold it 6 feet away from you, you have really long arms, but if you put it on the other side of the room, and then just take a step back, it should, what do you read? So squinting does the same effect, and you can't see the details, especially if you're nearsighted. You can read the Snapdragon stem right there. There's a lot of flowers that have that shape. There's a really strong shape of the darks of that thing. So, and then you've got the light sky around it. So in art speak, that dark shape, it happens to be dark in this particular painting. We'd call that the positive shape. That's kind of the subject matter, the recognizable thing that you're drawing people's attention to. It does happen to be dark in this particular instance. It doesn't have to be. It's the void in between that shape around it, that air around it with the sky. That's called a negative shape. And those can be just as important. And you're trying, maybe you ask, how can you have one without the other? You can't, really. I think some of the positive shape is partially what's into itself. So you've got more shapes with the petals onto the stem. I don't know. But it definitely is possible to think about the positive shape without thinking of the negative shape, even though you can't make one without the other. It's weird. I don't know that much about it yet. I know enough to pay attention to it and to have fun with it a little bit. Right now, to me, this whole Snapdragon thing looks like a mess. I feel like I'm narrating like this train wreck about to happen. It's like, oh my gosh, what's gonna happen next? And I'm the one who painted this thing. What are you doing, woman? More blues and greens. But I've seen the finished painting, and someone liked the finished painting and bought the little guy, so somebody knew what they were doing at one point. Enough to have somebody like it, so that works. Meanwhile, what the heck am I doing here? I'm adding some more blue. I don't like it. I wipe it off. I don't know. I'm making a pretty warm shadow down there. Warm shadows can almost feel darker, especially if you've got so many other cool things going on. I'm taking way too much. Is not one of the artist tools or a pigment that I'm aware of. It could be. I mean, there's a lot of deep thought for writers, and staring off into space is definitely a strong artistic tool. Usually we measure it. More dabbing, dabbing, dabbing over here. Again, I don't even know where I put these shapes anymore, but I know they are kind of four-petaled, but larger. I almost see a gladiola right now. And that's the nice thing about impressionist paintings like this. Like, yeah, I'd like to have specific snapdragons for people who like snapdragons and to also learn about the anatomy of snapdragons in particular. But if someone thinks they look like gladiolas or hyacinth, maybe, maybe not those, but another cone-shaped tall flower, and they're like, oh, it's one of these things. I really want to buy it. That helps me out as an artist, as you can imagine. So I kind of like that vaguity in some of the Impressionist paintings, because if someone has a deep memory attached to something and it happens to look like that, but it's not what I painted at all, cool. That works. I'd like to break down why I'm doing these little dabs where I am, because I think Impressionist painting is, and dabs of these things, I don't think there are that many lessons out there about that or how to. I want to say it feels intuitive, and that's not to say that I'm this high and mighty artist who knows exactly where these blobs go and I know what I'm doing, big fancy art professional. It doesn't feel like that at all. I'm intuitive by, I want to think I've painted enough that I'm like, oh my gosh, I need orange there instead of this one. But then you might see, oh, nope, not orange. Okay, go over it again. So there's a lot of back and forth like that, but also practice of knowing what color I want right there. And when it comes to doing lessons, I have learned at Michael's, and I'm bringing up lessons because when people ask for real-time painting, it's usually to learn some things. It's usually like, hey, how do you do this? Step by step, slow it down for me, please. So it's kind of a lesson in a way. When I did lessons at Michael's, I noticed I really had to stop and think about why I did certain steps and how to describe it. It was hard sometimes because I would do things that I picked up in practice from art school or otherwise, and I couldn't explain why, and how could be even harder, honestly. And some of my students who followed directions so darn carefully had some hilarious results when I didn't know how to describe exactly what I was doing. People out there, artists, beginner artists, you've got more intuition for, hey, this doesn't feel right, than you think, okay? It's like a little recipe. Like, if this feels like too much paint or not enough, listen to it. It's okay. Paint is cheap compared to your time. There are other examples for following directions and me giving interesting directions or having to break that down, but we won't go there. More stems! More brighter stems. This might be where I start doing that priming in again, where I want to have something even brighter on top of this, especially in that foreground in the bottom left. I'm going to be doing quite a bit right there to make those leaves really come forward on top of those little shadows over there. And I do know there's quite a lot of more little dabbing around with the flowers as well, but because I'm working back and forth like this, I let the flowers dry, definitely. That's one of the wonderful things about acrylics, is that they dry awfully darn fast. So yes, I use some of that slow dry medium in the beginning for some of the background. Especially when I need to mix up a little bit of a different color, it helps it. It's like a greasy, sticky, if it could be the same thing at the same time, greasy and sticky, but it helps to have it blend and it feels more buttery or more like margarine. No, wait. I meant marmalade. Something like jelly. I'm going too far here, but it, have fun with it. It does a different texture thing. It feels different when you blend with it. The tricky thing with a lot of acrylic mediums is they're usually white before they dry, just like Elmer's glue. Acrylic mediums tend to be clear acrylic paint with a different, you know, different qualities to them, but they're white as you mix them in. So if you mix them into a color, you better have the color you want before you start mixing it, or it will look lighter as you mix it around. Also, don't put it directly next to your white, or you will have very interesting results. I've never done that by experience myself whatsoever. it's possible to get a very streaky white glaze if you're not careful. White does not blend easily with some of these mediums because you can't see it unless it's a clear medium. There are some more liquidy mediums, but if you've got a thick white medium and white paint or a lighter color paint, you can't tell as well if it's blended all the way. So blend more, basically, is what you do. If you're mixing it with white, unless you want something streaky. Whatever you do, do it on purpose. And it becomes a technique. So here I'm adding some more dabby-dabby things on top of that flower to make it really pop forward. Something, it looks almost like an orange snapdragon. I think it still looks red in general. It's like your brain knows it's a red snapdragon, even though the paint says orange. What I have found is that if you're trying to lighten red with acrylic and you add white, you get this weird chalky nonsense. I don't know how to describe it exactly. It's a chalky pink. It's not light red. It's weird. So what I do is I add a little bit of yellow. I add some warmth to it. And sometimes, yes, it can go into orange, and sometimes that's just what it does. If you notice that big snapdragon in the middle, go down to the base on the left, that dark red, dark orange snapdragon, that's got a good deal of, little petal, it's got a good deal of yellow in it. And I think it looks like a dark red snapdragon still. That's what our brain fills in for us. But it doesn't feel chalky. It doesn't feel purple either, and it didn't go into brown, really. It still looks reddish-orange. So that's why I'll add a little bit of yellow if you're lightening a red and you don't really want it to read as pink or I say chalky. I probably should demonstrate on a card on what chalky means compared to something else, especially when it comes to acrylic. Something else you can do to avoid the chalkiness is to glaze. More acrylic techniques you can find on YouTube, or I can do other things. It's basically putting a transparent color on top of an opaque one or just another color, and it will glaze. It will put that transparent color and richen those layers. Light will bounce through all of that. And I'll usually use an acrylic medium like a gel to help me with that and get more light to go through the layers and more texture. I love texture on a canvas. I don't like colored canvases. I had a wonderful compliment once. I don't know what I was painting at the time, but there was very little texture of paint. And I like texture of paint. You could see the canvas texture underneath the whole thing, basically. And someone said they loved that because to them it felt like you knew what you were doing, so you don't have to go over it again and again. And you were conserving paint and blending and things like that. Which, thank you, whoever, you know, if you ever watch this, whoever you were, if you remember that kind of thing, I appreciate that, thank you. This is why I don't like it, because you can't tell the difference between that and a print sometimes. So if you ordered a print on canvas texture, it's just as smooth as a canvas texture. And I don't want a colored canvas. I want a painting, gosh darn it. I want to see the texture of the paint. There's such an action to it when you dab. And I mean, I'm all for blending. My attention span can't handle blending sometimes. That slow dry medium is wonderful for blending acrylics. And I might do other stuff with that. Choosing where to blend also is a tool in your arsenal for acrylics, but I'm a dabber. I like those spots. I go back and forth all the time, whether I like these big solid shapes of blendy or more dab big chunks, kind of a faceted look maybe, or just a big bold swash of color right there. And I think it takes, sometimes I feel like it takes more guts to put one big bold stroke of color with all the texture and all of its glory on a painting, because you could blendy something to death and you get sucked up in the details instead of one big bold, yes, this is the brushstroke right here, I'm going to put it on here, and I can't go back. To be said, it is very relaxing to blend those tiny little areas when I've got the attention span for it. So now that I've told you my entire philosophy about painting, while I'm doing dabby-dabby all around this little guy, I'm trying to think of other questions you might have. I feel like I actually put a different color blue right there, like a cerulean almost. I don't... maybe? It's mixing into the emerald green pretty well. Again, the emerald green color, it's... I call it canned color. It's already pre-mixed in the tube. Sometimes I'll use it as a feature color almost, because I can blend that with the other colors I've got to unify it around the painting a little bit. There's the again. But for this little guy, especially this emerald green, this is not the same emerald green that was the toxic emerald green with the arsenic, by the way. Shields green, it's not that color family. This is from Winsor & Newton. Also an older one, but still pretty good. It's also opaque, and I like it because it's opaque. The colors I have right here that I would have made green from, especially a dark one, that ultramarine blue, it's transparent, and the cadmium yellow is kind of sort of transparent, and I would have to lighten it up significantly to make it opaque enough for what I want, and then the colors shift and blah blah blah. So adding that canned green actually helps still have a vibrant color that you want, possibly lighter. That ultramarine blue light down in the corner was great. I probably did that the sky a little bit, or even some of the greens. I like that pre-mixed one because it's great for shadows, and honestly, it makes an amazing vibrant purple, which I did not add to this painting. Have fun with it. It's just acrylic. Of course it's acrylic. It's just ultramarine blue paint mixed with a ton of white and blended very, very, very nicely. I feel like they might do something different so that it's light but doesn't lose any of the vibrancy. Some whites can be very cool and can cool down what you're mixing it with. Sometimes the white can take away the vibrancy of a color. I don't know what they do. Maybe they have an actual layer of blue particle. It's cool stuff with science and art things. They go together a lot. More dabby dabby on that one. That's really looking orange right there. That's the highly scientific tool of a wad of paper towel. Also great for your art arsenal. Big wad of paper towel and your finger. Just smudge that stuff around. I'm trying to get more of that depth inside those little snapdragons right there. It'd be fascinating to see what I would do differently if I were to plan out close to the same kind of painting. There are so many different painting traditions and milestones that I think about and never do, like doing the same painting every year on a certain time and see how you've improved or where your style is going, or even just trying a different style with that one. You're an artist, you can do whatever painting as often as you stinking want. Might do this one again. I believe I also did this as a practice for a big stretched canvas that I had made. Big weird shaped canvas, because I make a lot of my own frames anyway. And you might have seen that picture at the beginning of the video. There were a lot of pinks, a lot of pink vibrant ones of the snapdragons from the conservatory. Really cool place, Garfield Park Conservatory in Chicago. Definitely check it out. We were there at the beginning of March, so we didn't go outside. It was cold. But this place is free as of 2020. Can't beat that. Nice warm place to go with lots of plants, suck, breathe in all the oxygen, walk around. There were a few of the, well, it's all buildings connected, a few of the rooms inside that were not as wheelchair friendly. My husband used the wheelchair, and so we go on adventures with that. Well, all throughout Michigan and events and things. I believe one of the main rooms there, because the building is just so stinking old, they didn't consider that at the time, and not many wheelchairs were made. So the majority of it is accessible. This was in their show garden, I believe. It felt like a springtime and Better Homes and Gardens. It was pretty. They're a place to sit. I hope they're doing well this year. Definitely recommend going back there. In Michigan, we've got the Frederick Meyer Gardens, which is very similar. It's paint. That's cool. It's also much, much larger outside and has a lot of sculptures. I believe Garfield Park does as well. But, you know, different stuff going on, different events. Another place we really love to go visit. Dabby, 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 more paint right there. I can't really tell you too much about what I'm doing and why. Partially because it's intuitive and partially because I recorded it so darn long ago. I'm touching up some shapes here and there if I had gone too far over with some of the Snapdragon petal shapes and making them darker. Dark and light directs where your eye goes. That and the tilt of those big Snapdragon cones right there also really direct where your eye is going. It's like a big arrow, honestly. And your eyes follow that curve. You'll see bottom right there, that Snapdragon cone right there. You see how it's almost at the edge. It was off the edge a little bit, but still curves up and back into the painting. So I'm not letting your eyes leave the painting right there, even though some of the Snapdragons on top are tilting out. If they all tilted in, it'd look weird. Or even on the bottom left-hand corner, that stem with little orange buds, I'm trying to cut your eye off from going out that corner, even though you've got this leaf, that bright white, yellow, green leaf, which I believe I'm going to go over again. It's almost tilting you out. I didn't want to have all the leaves go in the same direction because that would look weird, but I also didn't want your vision to go out of the painting quite right there anyway. You don't want, well, I shouldn't say you don't want, because you might want to actually. You might want to leave people's view outside of the painting. It's all about what you're choosing to do right here, but be aware, if you've got a strong line like that, people's eyes follow lines. So it's not about, you don't want to do this. Well, maybe you do. That's break the rules. This is why the rule's there. If that line is leading out, your eye is going to go out. Typically, in a lot of traditional painting, you don't want to do that. You want to keep people's eyes on your painting. Keep it interesting. You can lead their eyes around with contrast and lines and stuff like paint. Now I'm just getting tired. What's coming next, Brush? What's next? Oh, we're going for the edges. Are we going for the edges? I feel like we're going to the edges and we're tidying up and tiny little blobs. Please definitely follow me on Instagram if you like this kind of stuff and want to see more Michigan or Midwest or wherever the heck I get off to adventures and different projects I do, or if you have ideas for things you want to see. I love to experiment with all things acrylic, make them look like oils or watercolors or paint anything I can get my hands on. I'll try to add the link to where you can find prints of this little guy if you just love Snapdragon so much, or you see another flower in it and you just like those so much. Because the original is sold. It has found a good home by now. I feel like I almost remember who bought it, but I don't right now. I think it's like a family member or friend, so I should know. Well, thank you for giving it a good home. Everybody else, you can stick it on like phones, and it's actually really cool on a little phone case. Thank you all for watching. You have more ideas about stuff you want to see with acrylic painting and the adventures thereof. Please let me know. I can't always guarantee I can do those. Obviously, you know, it's time. It's what I can consistently do. It's what I can try to be good at and what my equipment can film. You know how it goes, but I'd like to hear what you want to see as well. And what is valuable for here, if it's not just my talk and voice over a time-lapse video when it comes to painting. Although those are kind of fun and they keep me on task when I can only paint for half an hour at a time. So thank you all for watching. Yes, there's like and subscribe. It helps those small artists and big artists out so much. Share with your friends if you're a big painting person. And thank you so much. Hope you have a good night.